consent on Nahuacalesis. And Dr. Romero holds a PhD in Latin American literature from the University of Utah. And she's currently the director of the Spanish interpreting program at the Department of World Languages at the College of St. Mary. Brenda, many thanks for being here. And the floor is all yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Christian, for that nice introduction. This is a topic that I feel very passionate about, so I really appreciate your invitation to be here today. I would like to begin by paraphrasing an article that appeared in the New York Times back in the 1980s. The piece referred to a 36-year-old Mexican man that went to the French National Library in Paris one morning and asked to look at a few books from their collection. He examined the items he requested and later left the library. That afternoon, a librarian noticed that one of those books, which was kept inside a wooden box because of its fragile state, was missing. The French police got involved, and they later found out that after leaving the library, this man had gone straight to the airport and boarded a flight back to Mexico, taking the missing book with him. This incident was the beginning of an international criminal investigation. This individual was eventually detained in Mexico, but avoided being extradited to France. And after much controversy and a lengthy series of negotiations, it was decided that the book would remain in Mexico. You might be wondering who would go into all this trouble for a book, and why the governments of two countries, Mexico and France, would be so interested in this one document. Well, as you can imagine, this was no ordinary book. This thief took a Mexican manuscript from the 16th century. It was a rare artifact, one of those artifacts known as Nahuacódices, and that is the topic of my presentation. Códices are handmade pictorial documents used to register information. They were usually made out of long strips of paper, it's called amate paper, and folded accordion style. This pre-Hispanic bookmaking was practiced for centuries before the Spanish conquest, in the geographical area known as Mesoamerica. And here's a map so you can have a visual reference of where Mesoamerica is. Many of these books recorded the history of a town or specific ethnicity. Some contain information regarding their gods and religious ceremonies, while others had very practical uses, such as documents that counted and classified the population, like our census, and also those that registered tribute, like our taxes nowadays. Códices were part of both Aztec and Mayan civilizations. While Mayans used hieroglyphics to represent specific words or syllables, Aztecs used a complex system of symbols to represent words, ideas, and concepts. The books produced in the region that was part of the Aztec Empire are known as Nahuacódices, because these communities were speakers of the Nahuatl language. In the Aztec society, there were two types of individuals directly associated with the Códices, Tlacuilo and Tlamatini. Tlacuilo is the word in Nahuatl for painter or scribe, and Tlamatini means reader of Códices. Both painters and readers of Códices studied in the Calmeca, that's the school for the Aztec nobility. The Tlacuilo, or painter, became skilled at making ink and paper from natural sources, trees, plants, minerals, and learned the symbols using these books to register information. On the other hand, the Tlamatini learned to read these books. The Aztec concept of reading was very different to our current notion. Nowadays, we think of reading as an individual activity done usually in silence. For the Aztecs, reading a codex was an event. The Tlamatini would read the codex in front of a small or large audience. At the Calmeca, their school, the Tlamatini would learn the meaning of the figures used in these books and the details behind each of them. The reading of Códices has been explained by experts in different ways. One common explanation is that the codex is the equivalent of a handout, that piece of paper that we normally get at classes or at a presentation, and contains only the main points or basic information. But it is the professor or the presenter that gives you the explanation and the details to fully understand it. Another popular explanation is that a codex is like a music sheet that only someone with musical training can understand. We believe that both painters and readers, L'Aquilo and Tlamantini, were duties performed by men. However, there is an image in one codex that portrays a female painter. In any case, these painters had to follow certain rules to represent people, ideas, events, and things. Humans were painted in these books as generic male and female figures. They were not intended to resemble anyone in particular, but rather communicate the idea of man or woman. The four figures in this slide come from different codices, but look fairly similar. Men and women were painted in different resting positions, while the three male figures are painted sitting down with their feet up front. The woman is painted kneeling down. In addition to presenting a different posture, women were also painted with lighter skin and a different hairdo. Of the three male figures in the slide, two have positions of power. We can identify them because they are not sitting directly on the ground. Of these two important characters, we can recognize one as an Aztec priest because he's wearing a religious mask. The other one is a government leader. We can determine that because he's sitting in a more elaborated chair and wearing a crown. In fact, we can identify this last figure by name. His name is indicated by the drawing of a falling eagle next to his head. This is the Aztec emperor Cuauhtémoc, whose name in Nahuatl means falling eagle. In these pictorial books, names, things, and ideas were represented in four different forms. The pictorial form, there's a snake, representing a snake, or like Cuauhtémoc's name, there's a falling eagle. Another form of representation was ideographic, when a related symbol is used to signify an idea. For example, the image of a temple on fire is the representation of war. There were also logographic representations, which is having an unrelated symbol represent an idea. For instance, the symbol for the number 8,000. And finally, there was also phonetic representation that was similar to what we see in Mayan codices. This is the combination of sounds of the names of different things painted together to form a name. In this case, the words for hand, moss, and hill in Nahuatl to indicate the name of the town, Mapachtepec. In terms of numbers and dates, these were the symbols employed in those books. To represent a specific quantity, they would use the combination of these numbers. Yes, these are the only number symbols they had. So for example, if they wanted to represent the number 5,000, they will have to draw many feathers and some flags to add up to 5,000, and so on. For dates, they would use a series of numbers from 1 to 13 and the rotation of four figures, flint, reed, house, and rabbit, usually drawn inside a square. Nowadays, we think of time in terms of years, decades, and centuries. That is groups of 10 years and groups of 100 years. The Nahuas divided time differently. They had years, then groups of 13 years, and then four sets of groups of 13 years to form a cycle of 52 years. I'm in the humanities, so numbers are not my thing. like to think of it in a very simple way. Their decades were of 13 years, and their centuries were of 52 years. This is an example of a codex where numbers are an important element. This image is part of the last section of the Codex Mendoza, which in Spanish is known as Matrícula de Tributos, or Tribute Registry. And here you can see what and how much of it was given as tribute every year by certain towns to the Aztec capital of Tenochtitlan. On the margin, we see the names of towns, while in the inside, we find the items and quantities needed for each item. So I'm gonna stand up just to point at some items here. So here you can see the names of the towns, and here you can see what they have to pay as tribute. So these towns were in charge of giving this tribute every year to the town of Tenochtitlan. So besides different types of textiles and some uniforms for their army, these towns have to give some cotton, some beans, and some honey. Exactly, it was 400 boxes of cotton, 8,000 baskets of beans, and 200 jars of honey. You can see the numbers there. So that's how you can start looking at how this is like their bookkeeping, their taxes in that time. We believe that there were buildings specially dedicated to store those pictorial books, thousands of books, like our libraries today. However, all of this changed with the arrival of the Spanish conquistadors. In 1519, Hernán Cortés and his men arrived in Mexico. And later, after the conquest, many other Spanish officials and clergy came to the region. They tried to compare the codices to what they had back in Europe. Their concept of book was not very different to what we have today. The printing press was already in existence, and this is an example of a Bible from that time. Spaniards also tried to compare codices to their art. El Greco is one of Spain's best known 16th century painters. And as you can see, the idea was for paintings to look almost like photographs. Spaniards came with those ideas of what a book should look like and what art should look like, but they found something very different. They didn't understand these books, and they didn't think they were of any value. On the contrary, they wanted to destroy them. Let's remember, this was the time of the Spanish Inquisition. So, the general opinion at that moment was that these paintings must have been inspired by the devil. Spanish priests like Diego de Landa considered these documents profane and dangerous and ordered them to be burned. There were so many of these books to be burned that some of those fires lasted for days. During the colonial period, when Mexico was part of the Spanish Empire, more codices were produced, this time under the supervision of mostly Spanish historians and religious officials interested in learning about the past and beliefs of the indigenous population. Fray Diego Duran and Bernardino de Sahagún were part of these efforts. Former Tlaquilos painters were trained in monasteries. In addition to being introduced to Christianity, at these centers, they also learn alphabetic writing. In the early years, colonial codices followed the pre-Hispanic techniques. But as time went by, the native painters began a process of transculturation. They adopted European artistic techniques and began including words. Gradually, alphabetic writing gained precedence, and by the end of the colonial period, codex looked more like an illustrated book. After recognizing the importance of the codices as registry of a variety of information from the Nahua society, the Spaniards employed these pictorial these pictorial books for their own benefit. In the colonial period, one method that the Spanish government used to manage the land and the people of their colonies was called the encomienda system. With this system, a Spanish individual called the encomendero was provided with a piece of land, including authority over its natural resources and its native residents. This individual will be in charge of supervising the work of the natives living in his land and collect tribute from them. Part of the tribute will be for himself, a part for the King of Spain. In exchange, the encomendero had the duty of introducing the natives living in his land to Christianity. The codices were useful for the Spaniards in the establishment of the encomienda system. Some codices that registered geographical information and town boundaries were employed in decisions regarding land distribution among encomenderos, while those books that recorded tribute were employed by encomenderos to establish the tribute amounts that they would collect from their native subjects. As it is true for other societies, history was a crucial topic for the Nahua people. The Nahua codices of historical content, my favorite type, are called anales. These indigenous manuscripts recount history from a local rather than an empire-wide perspective and display time as their structural element. These codices record the history of a specific community following a chronological order year by year, from its origins to the moment when the book was created. This uninterrupted sequence connects the most memorable events in the history of that community with the present, establishing a connection between their ancestors and their current leaders. Therefore, this visual link of past and present reinforces the community identity. The information that was commonly registered in Nahua codices of historical content, included the coronation and death of government leaders, battles, as well as weather-related and catastrophic events such as earthquakes, blizzards, eclipses, droughts, and floods. In the colonial period, codices will also register the building of the town's church and the establishment of a patron saint. Their typical structure was a horizontal year sequence, left to right, with a pictorial representation of the most relevant events under the corresponding yearbox. The Codex Tellerianorromensis is an example of this pattern. Other Nahua codices of historical content group a number of years in a block and use the space to represent the most important events in that period of time. One example of this alternative format is the first folio of the Codex Mendoza, the image that was used in the flyer to advertise this talk. This page includes the main events of a period of several years. We see a sequence of years that go around from the year 2 House, so 1325, to the year 13 Reed, or 1376. The information that takes center stage is the establishment of the Aztec capital, Tenochtitlan. We see the image of the eagle on top of the cactus that indicated, according to Aztec mythology, the place where they should settle. This city was founded on an island in the Lake of Texcoco, and that explains the blue frame and crossing lines. That's water. The upper part of the page also mentions the protagonists of this period of time, 10 individuals to be exact. 9 of them are army leaders. We know that because of their hairdo, a sort of half ponytail. Their names are specified by the glyphs drawn next to their heads, and their rank is indicated by the number of green branches other male figure, the one closest to the eagle, is a political and religious leader. Like the others, we see the representation of his name next to his head. His religious authority is designated by the gray color of his face and his red earpiece. His political power is indicated by his seat and the turquoise speech sign coming out of his mouth. He is the one that commands the people from his royal seat. In addition to the founding of the Aztec capital of Tenochtitlan and the protagonists of that period of time, this folio also mentions in the lower section two important battles. The temples on fire indicate the concept of war. And next to each temple, we see the representation of the names of the town where these battles happen. In this case, these are encounters against the people of Coloacan and Tenayuca. Aztecs were victorious both times, and we know that because the Aztec warriors, which we can identify by their shields with eight feather pieces, are not only drawn larger in size, but are also visually portrayed as victors and in control. In contrast to their smaller counterparts, who are smaller, barefoot, and arched, the Aztec warriors are standing up, wearing sandals, and holding their weapons. Recording history in the Nahua Codices was a selective and subjective process. Since one of the goals of these pictorial books was to portray a history that the community would feel proud of, it was common that in terms of battles, victories were always registered in the codices, but very often defeats were omitted. These manuscripts recorded information from a specific perspective and at a particular moment in time. For the Nahuas, history was fluid and manipulated. The tlacuilo, or painter, will emphasize or overlook certain facts depending on what was convenient and advantageous for their community at that specific moment. For instance, if their community had engaged in battle against the Spaniards during the conquest, the tlacuilo would register in that specific codex the arrival of the Spaniards to the territory, but would omit their participation in a war against those who were now in power. The Lienzo de Tlaxcala is an example of this phenomenon. That codex intentionally manipulates the information. It does not portray the early battles between the Tlaxcaltecas and the Spaniards, but does register the events that follow the establishment of their alliance against the Aztecs. If the information recorded in a codex was no longer fitting for the community because of a major event like the conquest, or because all enemies became allies or vice versa, the old book will be destroyed and a new history will be written in a new codex. I began my presentation talking about a man who stole one of these documents from a library in Paris. So I would like to now share with you some information about the location of some of the best known Mexican codices. As you can see, even though these books register aspects of the indigenous Mexican societies, they are not in Mexico, but rather held in European libraries. Each of these books has a story. Some were at some point given to a king or a member of the nobility or even the Pope, while others were trafficked by pirates. With time, most of them ended in a private collection and eventually made their way to these libraries. As you can imagine, after that incident back in the 1980s, direct access to these books became stricter. But thanks to technology, some of these manuscripts are now available in digital format online. Finally, I would like to tell you very briefly about my personal connection with the codices, how I got started with this. Years ago, when I was a graduate student, I heard from one of my professors that the library at the University of Utah, where I was studying, had a large collection of facsimiles, which is exact replicas of Mexican codices, specifically Nahua codices. When that semester ended, I decided to go to the university library and take a look at those codices. I did not know anything about those manuscripts. I was pursuing a degree in Latin American literature. I was studying Neruda and García Márquez. So I really didn't know what to expect. It was pure curiosity what pushed me to look for them. These items were kept at the rare collection section of the library, and to have access to them was an event. You had to leave all your belongings in a locker, everything, no phone, no computer, wear no jewelry, pass through airport-like security, wear gloves, examine the items under a special lamp, and take notes using some yellow pieces of paper and tiny pencils that they provided. My first time there, I saw the catalog and randomly chose one codex, then another one, and later one more. I became fascinated by these documents, and that summer, I went to the rare collection section of the library every day. At the beginning, I had no idea what I was looking at. These books had no front cover, no page number, index, and most of them had no words. I felt challenged but intrigued at the same time. And as weeks went by, I started making sense of them, recognizing dates, names, places, dates, and the rest is history. Thank you.
So I would like to open up for questions now. If anyone has a question or comment, I'd like to ask Dr. Romero.
So as far as the rewording, this is titled as Nahuatl Codices in Writing and Rewriting Aztec History. And what aspect are you sharing, like the rewarding portion of it? I know you're sharing, publicizing what they meant. Mm-hmm. As far as
the rewriting?
Yes.
What's the rewriting part?
Yes.
So whenever something important or significant happened and they felt that the history that was written in their books had to be changed, they will destroy those books. They will burn them. And they will write a new history. So if they had old enemies, and in their books they portray the battles that they had with these enemies, and now they were their allies, then they will go and write a new book where they will omit those battles against them because now they're our allies.
Okay.
So, and they saw that as the way things work. That was their concept of history. That history belonged to them. That they were the writers of their own history. And that they had the freedom to do that if they wanted to.
Like modern day politics, huh?
An interpretation.
Choosing to ignore, certain past as well.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, a little bit kind of related to it. At what point, do not know if you know about this, but at what point perhaps the Spaniards began to use the system used by the elite, because this was just knowledge given to a specific group of people. It was not for everyone. And they aimed to educate and incorporate these elite members, the ones that were willing to submit to them. At what point did they use this knowledge to start teaching the new religion? Do you have any references of that?
Yes, they did use this. Like I said, at the beginning, the value of these codices was not seen, so most of them were destroyed. So most of the codices that we have now were elaborated during the colonial period. They're not purely pre-Hispanic. However, later, when they saw, oh, these are not just random pictures. These are valuable. They have information. This is how they register their information. Yes, the Spaniards saw this as a tool that they could use to Christianize the natives. And there are actually codices that are called codices de catecismo that teach with pictures about Christianity. So yes, they did use this as a tool to teach the natives about Christianity. Yes.
Before the Spaniards came, they would use them as sort of like an event and tell, but they would they go back in history to say it, or would they just, would they use like older ones, or just kind of they were using new ones sort of as flyers or pamphlets, or would they go back and read other ones from previous years or something, I guess?
Codices of historical content is just one type of a wide variety of codices.
Okay.
There are codices that have to do with the gods, that have to do with a calendar, that have to do with locations, geographical information. There were some codices that record the type of punishments that parents should give to their kids. There were codices of a wide, wide variety. So is the historical are just a tiny piece of this huge range of codices. So what we know about the reading of codices is that, yes, it was an event because the person that could interpret those codices needed to have that specific, very particular knowledge. We do not know if Tlamatini, which is the reader, could read any codex or if they had a specialty. Like, you're specializing in these ones, you're specializing in these ones, and these are the ones that you can read. And so they would read it to an audience that was interested in that. Yes?
So the codices were they given to the public to read? They were only read aloud?
Yes. You will need to have specialized knowledge to be able to know what was there. As you can see in the images that I use in my presentation, many of these codices, besides the pictures, they have writing. They have words in there. When the Spaniards received these codices or found these codices or asked people to make it for them, they didn't think that the pictures were enough. So they wanted to be able to understand them. And so they wrote all these notes in there. And for many years, experts or people in academia were just looking at those codices and assuming that those writings were correct. Oh yeah, this one happened in 1425 because here there's some sign with some pictures, but it says 1425 here, so that must be right. And now, many studies have shown that some of those writings were done by people that did not have that specialized training and the specialized knowledge. And now there are a lot of corrections to those. Sometimes that, like some of the pictures that I show you from the Codex Mendoza, the one from the Tribute, some of the names of the towns that are indicated by the picture, some of the names are switched. It's not a correct name of the town. And for years and years, we assume, yeah, that's the town because it's written there. So yes, you will need to have very specialized knowledge. It was not something that everybody could read.
When you met as Javi, how did you interpret and do your interpretations align with what was presented for those codices? You said you made a hobby going almost every day, and you said, like, so I'm assuming that you read some of it, or not read, but like looked at the codices and interpreted, okay, so from what I know, my knowledge is this, now I'm interpreting what they might have meant on this. Like, did they align with what was written about them, or what information was provided with them?
When I said that I started going every day, I have to confess that it was a very slow process. It's like learning another language. This is a language with pictures. And so I had to rely on what other people had done. And there are some books, and I brought some here today. Like for example, this one, this talks about all the names that correspond to signs that have to do with the human body. A hand, a foot, an ear, a head, etc. And this is just for the human body. So then there are, I had to do a lot of research to be able to familiarize myself with names and how the combination of different words means something else. And so I have studied only the ones of historical content. If you put me up in front of a college that's got like a census or something else, it will be a little difficult for me to read because there's so much, there's so many words and so many symbols. But yeah, since my training is in literature, I guess that's why I like the historical codices the best, because I read them as a text, not as a painting. And just like any text, like a poem or a novel, I like to read them and then interpret and try to read between the lines. And try to make sense of these indigenous voices that are coming out of these texts.
Is there anything that really stood out to you from when you were making that aloha? Like, what was something that you discovered, I mean, I guess, that really stood out to you in that historical sense?
One thing that I have written about is the representation of Moctezuma in the codices. Even though he was the Huey Tlatoani, the emperor of the Aztecs, it was very interesting to me that his pictorial representation was very different depending on the origin of the codex. So the way he was seen by people from different towns in his empire was very different. Those people that were part of the center of the capital, Tenochtitlan, saw him this way, but their subjects saw him in a very different way. So that was one of the things that I have found very interesting.
You mentioned a lot of the codices were destroyed during the conquest.
Mm-hmm.
How many pre-conquest codices are there?
A handful. Very few. And mostly are Mayan and Mixtec. Mm-hmm.
you interpret him, Montezuma?
The towns that were powerful saw Moctezuma as in a positive way. They saw him as powerful, but the people in the periphery, the people that were subjected and had to pay tribute, they portrayed Moctezuma in a negative way in their codices. So in the codices you can see not only, you can see information not only about who is being portrayed, but also who is portraying him. So from the author, the Tlahuilos.
If Montezuma is portrayed as a specific historical figure in the surviving codices, is there any portrayal of Cortez or Malinche?
Mm-hmm. Yes. The Tlaxcala, the Codex of Tlaxcala, that's the one that has several images of not only Moctezuma, but also Cortez and Malinche. And it is very interesting that Malinche is always portrayed larger in size than Moctezuma and Cortez.
Huh.
That she's seen like a protagonist in those scenes. And so her abilities to be the interpreter between these two powerful men is seen as the Tlahuilos of Tlaxcala as very important. Because visually, she's there in the center and larger than
and,
the other figures.
And where is that particular codex?
Tlaxcala.
Oh,
Tlaxcala. Tlaxcala.
Okay.
Yes, Tlaxcala.
And how many are in Mexico now?
Only a few.
Yeah.
Only
yeah.
a few. Most of them are in Europe. And having access to them is very hard.
So, any other questions or comments? Thanks, Brenda, for this extremely interesting talk, I think, for me.